Hi, this is Gary with MacMost Now. On this episode, let's look at some cool features of the Chrome browser on Mac. So the Chrome browser and Safari are very similar. In fact, they use the same WebKit display engine. But each has its own unique features. So let's focus on some interesting features of Chrome. Now with Chrome, just like with Safari and most other apps now on the Mac, you can go to a full screen. You can enter full screen mode or click here and view the entire thing in full screen. But Chrome also has something called presentation mode, which goes a step further. It actually even gets rid of everything at the top of the screen and you just have the web content. You can still access the stuff by moving your cursor all the way to the top and you'll see it drops down. So it's kind of similar to full screen in that way, but here you get everything here. And if you're presenting a website on a projector to a room of people, or you just want to focus in on the content and not be bothered by everything else, it's an interesting feature to use. Now most browsers have privacy functions, like you can turn them on and then it's no longer recording your history as you browse different web pages. Chrome has an interesting feature called the incognito window, which basically allows you to keep your current window open and it opens up another window here, and stuff here in this window won't actually record where you're going. So for instance, if you're shopping for a surprise present for your spouse, you can go into an incognito window, shop in there, and then not have to worry about them seeing those sites show up in your history. Chrome lets you get a lot of information about the websites that you're browsing. And one way it does that is by allowing you to click the icon here that you see in the address bar. And when you do, you get this drop-down menu here that shows you information, say, about cookies and site data, also about the type of connection you have with the site. And you can even customize the settings specific to the website. For instance, if you wanted to block or unblock pop-ups on a certain site. Maybe you have a site that you go to where pop-ups are required for some functionality. You can change that just for that one site. And same thing with plugins and location information, notifications, all sorts of different things that a website can do. You can customize for a specific site in this menu. Now, have you ever been browsing around the web and accidentally your fingers hit Command Q and there goes everything. It's all gone. And you can load up the browser and reload all those pages. But actually in Chrome, there's a way to prevent that. You can go to the Chrome menu here and go to Warn Before Quitting. And when you select that, you can see it's turned on now. If I were to hit Command Q, it will tell me that I have to hold Command Q to quit. So a quick tap won't do that. I have to Command Q and hold it for a few seconds in order for a quit to happen. And then of course I could just turn that off if I want as well. Chrome also has an interesting way of handling Flash. Usually Flash is downloaded as a plugin stored in a central location of the system and accessed by all the different browsers. But with Chrome, it's actually kind of built into the browser. It's still a plugin, but it's independent of the other plugins for other browsers. So the way it handles it is a little bit more secure, a little bit more robust, and it makes Chrome very useful as a browser to use Flash in. So for some people, I've noticed they've gone with Safari with Flash disabled and in Chrome with Flash enabled, and whenever they want to view Flash content, like say play one of the games at my site, they use Chrome to do it rather than Safari or another browser. Now if you're more in the Google ecosystem than the Apple one, well, Chrome has some advantages for you because you can sign into Chrome, which is basically signing into your Google account. If I go to Preferences here in Chrome, you can see I can sign in and then I can sync bookmarks and other things between say an Android device and Chrome on my Mac. And it's also allows you to have multiple users, so you can add several users here in Chrome and then switch between them, not having to actually change users on your Mac or even leave the browser at all. So very useful for people using the Google ecosystem, which of course is cross-platform. So if you're using Mac and Windows and Android as well, and even iPhone with the Google apps there, you can use your account to go between them and have some data sharing like bookmarks. Chrome tries to be very robust by managing different tasks as different processes. So if a web page crashes, it doesn't take the whole browser with it. And you can kind of access this by going to Window Task Manager. And in here it will show you the different processes running inside of Chrome. So for instance, you can see plugins that are running, the different pages that are running, things like that. You can access them and actually even kill that process. So kind of like an operating system inside an operating system here with this task manager. You also have this little link down here, Stats for Nerds, and it gives you all sorts of detail and information about the different processors and things running inside of Chrome and how much memory they're using, things like that. So I always advise people to go ahead and install multiple browsers on their Mac, especially if you want to explore how each one is different and what features they have. So I've got Safari and Firefox and Chrome there, and sometimes I'll randomly use one instead of the other just to explore it and get used to it. Getting Google Chrome is pretty easy. If you don't already have it, just go to google.com/chrome and download it from there, and it lives on your Mac perfectly happily alongside of Safari and any other browser you have installed. Hope you found this useful. Till next time, this is Gary with MacMost Now. If you found this video useful, there's one thing you can do for me in return. It won't cost you anything and it will just take you a few seconds. If you're not already at MacMost.com, go there and then look for the video you just watched and go to that page. Underneath the video you'll see a bunch of different links that help you share the video with friends. Take a second to click the like button. This sends a signal out to the rest of the internet that the video is worth watching. Thanks.